Go with me tonight to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. And we want to deal with the subject tonight, purposes of the rapture. Purposes of the rapture. There are purposes for the catching away of the church that the Bible talks about. And now the reason I'm dealing with these things is, number one, I believe that the catching away of the church is imminent. I believe that we're closer than we've ever been. And, you know, I know that I know ministers have been saying that for a long time. And that's okay. I mean, Peter said that since the days of Jesus, it's been being said. And, you know, some people, they say, well, where is the promise of his coming if he's going to come? Well, I mean, Peter said a day with the Lord is as 1,000 years, 1,000 years as a day. And I mean, that was not necessarily a exact reference, time reference. But here's the issue, is if you use that formula, it's only been 2 days since Jesus left the earth. And the third day is coming. Amen. Hallelujah. And on the third day, you know what happens. Amen. That great getting up morning. Amen. But there are purposes, because what I find very often, and, you know, I've said this over the years, when I was growing up in church, there were things, now I was raised Pentecostal, thank God, and there were things that you heard always in church. You always heard Acts 2:4, always, Acts chapter 2, verse 4, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and spake with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance, all filled in the upper room. You always heard that, all right? And then you always heard Jesus is coming soon. The rapture of the church is imminent. It could happen any day. Amen. I mean, they wrote songs about it. I'll see you in the rapture. If we never meet again on this earth, my precious friend, if to God we have been true and we've lived above all sin, then for us there'll be a meeting. There's going to be a greeting. I'll see you in the rapture some sweet day. Now, I don't know if I'll see you in the rapture. I'm not going to be looking for you, to be honest. Amen. The Bible says I'm going to be looking for him. But the point is it I don't want to use the term, it kept people living right, but it kept their minds focused on the eternal and not on the temporal. Amen. And so 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 13. I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that you sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. And that's a whole teaching, that when a believer dies, we don't sorrow because we have hope. What do we have hope? We have hope of eternal life. Hallelujah. For if we believe Jesus died and rose again, even so, them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord. So Paul says, I'm saying this by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep or who have passed away. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout. Now, this is so interesting. And again, we don't use visions and whatnot as doctrine. But I remember Jesse Duplantis talking about, you know, he wrote a book called Close Encounters of the God Kind when the Lord took him to heaven. And he said that he was there in heaven, and that there was this whole group gathered in this, like this huge coliseum. And it had a roof on it. And it said everybody, the whole crowd was just buzzing because Jesus was going to preach that day. Whew. Amen. And he said Jesus came out and preached. He said he didn't teach, he preached. And he said the shouting and the praising God was so loud and the preaching was so dynamic. He said the roof started raising off that place. Hallelujah. Well, see, we got Bible proof for that right here. The Lord will descend from heaven with a shout. Jesus is not just coming back for the church. He's coming back shouting for the church. Hallelujah. With the voice of the archangel, the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Everybody say first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. The key to this passage is we are caught up. All right? It's the Greek word harpazo, and it means to be snatched away violently or moved from one place to another. Now, the key is that we're caught up. The dead in Christ are caught up first, and then we that are alive and remain will be caught up after them. Amen. The key is that we are caught up. Now, look over here at John 14. Glory to God. John chapter 14, verse 1. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions or dwelling places. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. Think about it. Jesus said one of the main reasons for him going away was so he could prepare a place for us. Ooh, glory. What? That where I am, I will come again and receive you, notice this, unto myself. That where I am, there you may be also. So Jesus has gone to prepare a place for us. He's gone to prepare a dwelling place for us. And then he's going to come again and receive us to himself. Hallelujah. Tell your neighbor, Jesus has gone to prepare a place for me. Now, here's why we want to focus on these eternal things. We can get so caught up in carnality. And here's what I mean by this. Enjoying the things of the world too much. Are you with me? That it begins to control us. It begins to control our thinking. It begins to control my desires. Amen. Because we get so caught up just enjoying things too much. You know, there's nothing wrong with a piece of pie. But to sit down and enjoy the whole pie, there's something wrong with that. Okay? Do you understand? And here's what I'm concerned that happens, is that especially in the day and age we live in, we get so caught up in what's going on externally and what's going on temporally in this world. I don't care what it is. We can get so caught up in the election. We can get so caught up in how bad things are. We forget Jesus went to prepare us a place, and he's going to return for the church and receive us unto himself. It doesn't matter how bad it gets on the earth. I already got a place prepared for me with the Father. It doesn't matter how sinful it gets on the earth. I already have a promise that a place has been prepared for me with Jesus, and that Jesus himself is going to return, and he's going to come shouting, and there's going to be a trumpet blowing, and I'm going to be received unto him. Hallelujah. Doesn't matter how bad it is on the earth. Amen. So I don't want to get so caught up in that it begins to control me. There are people that their mindset, their lives, they're just so melancholy because of everything that's going on in the earth. Listen, the Bible tells us that the darkness will get more dark, but the light will get lighter. It tells us that the wicked will get more wicked, but the righteous will be bold as a lion. Jesus said all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. We're hearing of wars and rumors of wars. Nations are rising against nation. Earthquakes in diverse places. But the end is not yet. What's our job? Keep occupying. Keep preaching the gospel. Keep getting people saved. Keep getting people healed. Keep getting people set free. Why? That's our job. Our job is to get souls into the kingdom. Our job is to get people born again and set free by the power of God. Why? One day Jesus is coming. He's going to receive us to himself. Hallelujah. Now, oh glory. Look at Luke 21. and verse 34. This is my introduction. He says, and take heed to yourselves, lest at any time your hearts be overcharged with surfeiting and drunkenness and cares of this life, so that that day come upon you unawares. Listen, pleasure and enjoyment. Listen, I don't know anybody that enjoys their life more than me. I don't know the person that enjoys their life more than I do. I enjoy my life. But here's the point. Pleasure and enjoyment are not wrong, but if allowed to be out of their place, they can become a distraction. We live for the eternal in a temporal world. We live in a temporal body that needs rest, it needs relaxation, it needs enjoyment for a balance. But I can get that out of balance. He said, don't become overcharged with this stuff. And notice what else he mentions, anxieties. Amen. Don't get overcharged with anxieties. You know, surfeiting, that's overeating. Drunkenness. We don't have any drunks in here, I know. Hallelujah. Such were some of us before we got saved. But the point is, he said, don't be overcharged with it. Why? That day will come on you unawares. The cares of this world. You can get so focused on what's going on in the world and get so anxious about it, you miss what God's doing. And it becomes a distraction. Amen. Preachers get so caught up in what's going on in the world, they use their pulpit to espouse their political beliefs. And they use their pulpit to try to fix the woes of the world. And we've never been called to do that. I've not been called to espouse what I believe politically. I've been called to teach you what the Word of God says and to make you part of that glorious company that does not have spot or wrinkle or any blemish in them, so that when that trumpet sounds and the shout of the Lord occurs, we're ready to go. Yeah. Amen. Yeah. Hallelujah. Now, there are purposes for the rapture. The very first, number one, to receive us to himself. The very first purpose is to receive us to himself. Look at Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 27. That he might present it, the church, to himself, a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but it should be holy and without blemish. The Woosh Bible says, in order that he might himself present to himself the church glorious. Woo! See, here's what I want you to understand. Boy, the glory's here too. Here's what I want you to understand. The church is not weak, failing, being overcome by evil. How do I know? Because he says the purpose of the fivefold ministry, the purpose of the word, is to produce a glorious church that does not have spot or wrinkle or any such blemish. So he wants to present himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such things, but in order that it might be holy and unblameable. So God wants us to be presented to himself. And he will present his church to himself without spot. That means a stain or a blemish or a defect. But he will present to himself a glorious church. Hallelujah. Say out loud, we are a glorious church. That's the church he's going to receive to himself. Amen. That's the church that Jesus Christ in the rapture, the catching away of the church that leaves is going to be a glorious church without spot or wrinkle or any blemish or any stain. Hallelujah. Why? Because we've, number one, made our robes white in the blood of the Lamb. We've accepted Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, and we are the righteousness of God in Christ. We stand just as clean today before God as we were when we were born naturally in this people planet. There's nothing between us and God. We are the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. We are a mighty moving force that must be contended with by the forces of hell. The gates of hell shall not overcome the church, but the church will defeat the gates of hell on every score. Why? We are God's chosen people. We are God's children. We are God's sons and daughters. We are a peculiar people. We've been called to show forth the praises of our God. We're Holy Ghost filled. We're blood bought. We're spirit energized. We are the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. We cannot be defeated. We can't be beat back, pushed back, stopped, put down. Amen. Just when they think you killed us, we just come back. We're like a cork that's pushed down under a barrel. We just pop right back up to the top. Why? We can't lose because we're a glorious church. And that's the church Jesus is going to receive to himself. Hallelujah. Now, there's a lot going on in the church. There's a lot going on in the carnal church. There's a lot going on in the flesh church. In the spirit church, there's miracles happening. In the spiritual church, the dead are being raised. The blind eyes are being opened. Bodies are being healed. Churches are being built. Buildings are being built. Cities are being taken. Nations are being shaken because we are the glorious church. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Just a matter of time. It's just a matter of time. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Do you see that? Glory to God. You start thinking like the world does and start thinking like religion does. Well, you know, the church has so many problems. No, 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 no. Listen, the church has always been full of imperfect people doing mighty miraculous things. Amen. God knows what he's got to work with. He knows he's got you and I to work with. And he's chosen to call us glorious. He's chosen to call us set apart. He's chosen to call us his people. It says he is not ashamed to be called their God. God is not ashamed of you. God is not ashamed of me. God's not ashamed of his church. He said, it is by my church that the world, the princes of this age, will see the manifold wisdom of God. Hallelujah. Going to receive us to himself. Amen. And I'm going. Tell your neighbor, I'm going. Woo-hoo. Number two, to separate the righteous dead from the wicked dead. The rapture of the church, to separate the righteous dead from the wicked dead. Revelation chapter 20 and verse 4. And I saw thrones, and they that sat upon them, and judgment was given unto them, and the souls of them that were beheaded for the witness of Jesus and for the word of God, and which had not worshipped the beast, neither his image, neither received his mark on their foreheads or in their hands, and they lived and reigned with Christ 1,000 years, millennial reign. But the rest of the dead lived not again until the 1,000 years were finished. This is the first resurrection. Blessed and holy is he that hath part in the first resurrection. Why? On such the second death hath no power. Whew, that's me. But they shall be priests of God and of Christ and shall reign with him 1,000 years. Now we're going to read some more verses here. But the Bible calls the lake of fire the second death. It has no power over us. We have no appointment with judgment. We have no appointment with the lake of fire. Why? We are not the wicked. We are the righteous. Hallelujah. And the purpose of the rapture is to take the church and separate the righteous dead from the wicked dead. Amen. Now look here in verse 12. Am I helping you so far? Because I've already done it, whether you know it or not. I've already preached myself happy. Amen. Verse 12. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God. Now, recognize this is not you. We stand before the judgment seat of Christ. Not the great white throne judgment. Why? We've already been judged by God. And we've been judged righteous. Why? Because we received Jesus Christ. We will stand before the judgment seat of Christ to give an account for our works on this earth and to receive rewards based on those works. This is the unrighteous dead. And notice something. They stand before God and the books were opened. Every person, when they're born on this planet, a book was started. And it recorded every sin you ever committed. A lie, lust, unjust anger. And if you do not receive Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, it's not just a book, you get books. Some of y'all remember, some of y'all had volumes. Amen? Myself included. Volumes. Amen. The books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books. What are they judged according to? Their works. Now stop right there and let me say something. In the day of slick grace that we live in, they say works aren't important. If you're going to be judged according to your works, tell me how important they are. They're vital. Not works for salvation, works that you're called to do after you're born again. These sinners are judged according to the works that they did. You will be rewarded based on the works that you did. Amen. Yeah, but Jesus did it all. Jesus did it all that it takes for you to be saved. Jesus did every work that is required for you to be righteous and born again and holy and saved. Jesus did not do every work that you're supposed to do after you get born again. Thank you for that overwhelming response. See, if you go down that road, then you become a lazy Christian. There are things I'm supposed to be doing for God, and they're called works. Works of righteousness. Amen? These sinners are judged according to their works. Hallelujah. And the sea gave up the dead that were in it. And death and hell, or the grave, delivered up the dead that were in them. Remember, till this point, the unrighteous dead have not been resurrected. They didn't get resurrected when Jesus returned for the church. But they're brought up, and they were judged, every man, according to their works. Do you see that? And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. Spiritually dead forever. Total separation from God. The horror of hell and the lake of fire is not just going to be maggots that never die and flames that are never quenched. It's going to be unchangeable, eternal, without revocation, separation from God. I can never feel God's presence. I can never know His love. I can never know what it means to be in His presence anymore. Why? I'm totally separated from Him. Why? Because I chose to not receive Him when I lived on this earth, and my works bore that out, and because I was judged according to my works, and my works revealed that I was a sinner, the result is eternal separation from God. And God raptures the church to separate the righteous dead from the unrighteous dead. Hallelujah. Because remember, we're already up here reigning. The righteous dead are reigning with Christ 1,000 years. Even if you go by the way of the grave, God's going to resurrect your body, and you got a throne waiting on you in the 1,000-year reign of Christ. Your nameplate on it. You're going to rule and reign with Christ for 1,000 years. You're going to judge angels. You're going to judge devils. You're going to help Him rule the nations with a rod of iron. He's coming back to bring us and receive us unto Himself so He can separate the righteous dead from the unrighteous dead and help Him rule this earth. Glory be to God. That's exciting. Whew. Amen. Glory to God. Ain't no grave gonna hold this body down. There ain't no grave gonna hold this body down. When I hear that trumpet sound, I'm gonna get up out of the ground. There ain't no grave gonna hold my body down. Well, meet me, Jesus, meet me. Meet me in the middle of the hair. He's coming back to get me now. His glory I'm going to share. There ain't no grave. Woo! Glory to God. It just can't happen. The righteous dead and the unrighteous dead will be separated at that day. Am I helping you at all? Oh, glory. Our names are not in the books. Our name is in the book. The book of life. Those other books don't exist for us. I said those other books don't exist for us. The only book that exists for you and me is the book of life. When you were born again, every one of those books that were against you, the ink, the writing just supernaturally disappeared. It never existed. The book was never there. If they wanted to search for it, they couldn't find it because under S, there's no books for Philip Steele anymore. But if they went down the ledger in the book of life, under S, they find my name. Under B, they find your name. Under M, they find your name. Why? Because one day you made Jesus the Lord of your life and you decided it was better to live for Him than live for yourself, and you became a part of that great righteous company that's going to be around the throne of God forevermore. Woo! Amen. Can't hold me down. Can't hold me down. You can't hold me down. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Woo! Number three, to take the church to heaven to receive our reward. Revelation 22 and verse 12. Notice what he says. And behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me to give every man according to his as his work shall be. What we're doing on earth right now is determining our reward when Jesus takes us to heaven. What I'm doing right now is determining my reward when Jesus takes me to heaven. Hallelujah. The Apostle Paul said what will be tried, what will be put to the test for you and I is our works. And he said those works will be put through the test. They'll be put through the fire. And he said some of them will be burnt up. Well, why would those works be burnt up? Because they were works, either A, that God never asked us to do, or works of the flesh that did not amount to an eternal reward. He said they would be burnt up, but the soul would be saved. Then he said their works are going to go put through the fire, put through the test, and they're going to come out as gold. That's what we want. That's what we want.
But regardless, we get a reward. Hallelujah.
1 Peter chapter 5, verse 4 says, it says concerning the pastors, it says that if you do and you pastor the church the way the Lord Jesus would have you pastor it, it says when the chief shepherd shall appear, that you, the pastors, will receive a crown of glory that fadeth not away. I wrote in my Bible, that's the pastor's crown. I'm going to get one of them. I'm going to get one of them. And for eternity, while we walk through this new earth, we'll have that pastor's crown on. And people will say, there goes one of those pastors. There goes one of those shepherds that shepherded the kingdom of God on the earth. Amen. I believe personally that us pastors, we're going to go places. We're going to teach people. We're going to teach people that didn't get saved till the tribulation. We're going to teach those that never reached full maturity on the earth. We're going to teach them and lead them and train them and guide them. Why? Because God's not willing that anybody be immature or be a baby in Christ. I'm telling you what, the eternal, the supernatural is far more real than the temporal world that we're living in. It is far more powerful and far more real than what we can see with our eyes. Whoo, glory. Tell your neighbor, I got a reward coming. Tell him I might have a lot coming. Amen. See, listen, your reward is not heaven. Heaven is a stopover. You're not going to spend eternity in heaven. Heaven is a holding place. The Bible says that we will be caught up with Christ and we'll be at heaven. Revelation tells us we'll be at the marriage supper of the Lamb. You know, there's a wonderful story there. One time, Sister Jeannie Caldwell, she was praying and she was really in deep prayer. And she told the Lord, Jesus, she said, I would just like to touch you. And Jesus said, well, when you get to heaven, when I catch away the church and you get to heaven, he said, you can touch me all you want. And she said, but everybody will be wanting to touch you. And he said, Jeannie, at the marriage supper of the Lamb, I will personally serve you. That's all of us. Jesus will personally serve us. Why? It's his marriage supper. It's the Lamb's supper. You got born again and you got a place reserved at the marriage supper of the Lamb. You have a place of honor at Jesus' supper. And when the church is caught away in the rapture and we arrive there, they're getting it ready right now. Right now they're working to get it ready. The banquet hall's being prepared. The linens are being put on the table. Everything's being prepared. Why? Because that day's coming. And we're going to be caught away in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye. And it says we're going to be there at the marriage supper of the Lamb. Hallelujah. Do you see that? Heaven is not the reward. That's where we go and have our marriage supper with Jesus the Lamb. But then, the Father will look at the Son and say, it's time to go back now. And the Bible says he will get on a white horse and they will call him faithful and true. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And he'll put on that vesture that has been dipped in blood and put his legs across that white horse. And it says that all of the righteous saints that have been called away will come back together with him to judge this earth. That's going to be me and you. We're coming back to earth on a full stomach. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Won't need no peanuts on that trip. Amen. We will have eaten till we're full and come on back. Amen. It's real. Jesus is going to catch us away. The trumpet is going to sound. There's going to be the shout of the archangel. We are going to go be forever with him. We are going to attend the marriage supper of the Lamb. We are going to look on him who was pierced for our sins. We are going to look into his eyes. How do I know we'll be able to look into his eyes? Because when we see him, we shall be like him. Yes. Hallelujah. Yes. Glory to God. Think about it. Think about it for a minute. Forever with the Father.
forever with the Son. Not only trying to imagine in your mind what your place at the right hand of the Father looks like, but actually seeing your throne at the right hand of the Father. Actually seeing it. Actually being there. Actually seeing Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. What a day that will be. Amen. Do you see that? Sometimes that reality is lost on people in the church. That's why they used to sing songs like that. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see. When I look upon his face, the one that saved me by his grace. Then he'll take me by the hand and lead me to the promised land. What a day that will be. Now people have said, yeah, but you're putting everything off to the end. No, I'm not putting everything off to the end. I'm telling you that that is part of why I'm living the way I'm living. The reason why you deny yourself, the reason why you take up the cross and follow Christ, the reason why you choose to live a Christian life apart from the world and you choose to put your flesh down and live a life that's not carnal and not fleshly is because you know there are greater things in store for you than you've ever seen before. And Jesus is ready, willing, and able and waiting to come back and receive us unto himself. Amen. Hear your pastor tonight. Everything that you're doing to live for God, it is not in vain. There's a reward waiting on you. There's a reward waiting on you. And it's handpicked by God. It's handcrafted by heaven. Glory to God. Glory to God. There are people in here, sometimes you think, well, all I can do is pray. Yeah, and you're gonna pray yourself in to one of the biggest rewards that anybody ever seen, ever in the history of rewards. Amen. This life is not just about what I can get. It's not just about how I can prove that I'm prosperous to people. It's about I'm living for something bigger than myself. I'm living for an eternal purpose. Jesus did not save me just to give me a new car. Jesus saved me because I was a sinner and I was lost and I was on my way to hell and I couldn't save myself and I had no hope and I had no way of getting out of the sick cycle that I was in. But one day Jesus reached down a nail-pierced hand and brought me out of sin and saved my soul. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. That's why we're living the way we're living. We're not living right because we just want to be blessed. We're living right because somebody died for us. We're living right because there's blood between us and God. And it's the blood of the only of the spotless Lamb of God that was given without price. He did not charge us anything to be our substitute. He chose to do it of his own volition because of his love that he had for the Father and his love that he has for us. Every day when you get up, don't you let the devil tell you nobody cares about you, nobody thinks about you, nobody's concerned with you. Somebody was so concerned with you, they gave their life for you. Somebody was so concerned for you that they shed their blood for you. Somebody wanted you so free from drugs that they delivered you with their own blood. Glory to God. And not only that, then he reserved a place for you. And he's going to come back and receive you unto himself, that where he is, we may ever be. My Lord, I don't know if I'm helping you, but I'm helping me. Praise God. Amen. Amen. Do you see that? The only problem I see with some of the church today is they just need another dip. And I don't mean a dip of Copenhagen. They need another dip in the fountain. Amen. The fountain filled with blood. They need to remember where we came from. Sometimes we just need to sit back and think, where would I be if Jesus hadn't saved me? Where would I be if he hadn't reached way down for me? Where would my marriage be if Jesus hadn't rectified my life and brought me to a place of forgiveness and a place of love? Where would I be if it wasn't for him? And then shout about where he brought you from. and then shout about where he's taking you to. Woo!
Oh, I got two more points. Number four, to change us. To change us. Look at 1 Corinthians 15. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Maybe it's a sign I'm getting older. Maybe it's, I don't know what it is, but I'm telling you what. I just think about heaven a lot. Amen. And I don't mean gates of pearl and streets of gold. I mean Jesus. I just think about waking up one day, hallelujah, and just looking at Jesus. Amen. No, I'm not saying I want to hurry and go. I just think about it a lot. What a day that's going to be. Hallelujah. I say, what a day that's going to be. Hallelujah. 1 Corinthians 51. Or 15, verse 51. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep. Notice, so everybody's not going to die. But we shall all be changed. Ha, ha, ha. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised. Notice these words, incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on corruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. Hallelujah. The righteous dead will be raised incorruptible. That means they will never die again. Their bodies will never be corrupted by disease. Their body will never be corrupted by imperfection. Hallelujah. We shall be changed. Amen. And the righteous who are alive and remain will be put on incorruption. We'll put on incorruption. No matter how healthy you are, you will put on complete immortality. You will put on complete incorruption. You shall be changed in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye. Amen. Not going to take God 30 days to do a makeover. In the blink of an eye, you're going to be changed. Amen. Think about it. Perfect weight, perfect height, perfect skin, perfect everything, perfect heart, perfect lungs, perfect everything. Why? You're going to be changed. That's why he's going to rapture the church. So we can be changed. Hallelujah. So we can be changed. Now see, that's where people have made the mistake. Sometimes they have written songs about their old blue-haired grandma in heaven. Grandma's not blue-haired in heaven no more. Whew. You understand? Grandma's young. Grandma's busy. Amen. You understand? Why? Been changed. Been changed. Been changed. They've been changed. I said they've been changed. I remember my grandmother. I remember my grandmother Palmer. They used to ask her. She lived with us for a time. My grandfather died the same year, the same week I was born. And so 1966, he passed away. And my grandmother would come and stay with us for extended periods of time, especially in the summer. She would come and stay with us and watch us kids. And she always sat on the front row. And, you know, we didn't have such luxuries as padded seats. We had oak pews. And now some of y'all remember those oak pew days. Amen. Hallelujah. That's why as Pentecostals shouted so much. You had to get up and get some circulation going. Amen. Sitting on that wooden chair. Amen. Hallelujah. And my father always called my grandmother Sister Palmer. Always called her Sister Palmer, my mother's mother. And he would ask her. Now, you got to understand, my grandmother was a very plain woman. Her and my grandfather pastored a church in a one-room schoolhouse up in Alcorn Holler in Greenup County, Kentucky. All right, now, some of y'all are not country enough to know what a holler is, all right? But a holler
now they have roads. Used to be just a valley up between two hills, and you could holler up in there. And everybody could hear you in the holler. All right? Amen. And my grandfather worked for the C&O Railroad till he retired and pastored that church. And they were just good Pentecostal people. I mean, on fire for God. And my grandmother would always sit on the front row, and my father would ask her, he said, "Sister Palmer, do you have a testimony?" And she would stand up, and she always put her hands behind her back. And she was just very plain. Had her hair up, gray hair with a little black in it in a bun. One time I saw my grandmother with her hair down, and it scared me. That cannot be my grandmother. She has hair. And in any event, and she would just have a plain dress on. I don't remember exactly what it was. And she would stand there with her hands behind her back, and she would always do this right here. Rock on her feet. And she'd start talking about how she loved the Lord and talk about how good God had been to her. Amen. And then she'd start singing that song, "I'm going to hold to the plow. I'm going to do his work while there's strength in my body. I'm going to hold to the plow." I'm telling you what, I remember being a little kid sitting on that front row thinking, boy, my mamaw, boy, I just love my mamaw to hear her talk about Jesus. I can't wait to go to heaven and sit beside my mamaw and hear her talk about Jesus on a whole nother level, because she knows him better now than she's ever known him before. As good as she knew him then, she knows him on a whole nother level. Hallelujah. I don't know about you. There's nothing wrong with that. I want to see those that have went on before me. I want to meet my Grandpa Palmer. I never got to know him. I want to meet him. He's the one that led my mama to the Lord. He's the one that set my father down on a fireplace in their house and said, "Look, people are going to make fun of you. They're going to call you lazy because you're dedicating your life to the things of God." He said, "Son, don't you ever give up on what God's called you to do, because it's the greatest thing you could ever do with your life is to go do what God's asked you to do." There are people waiting on you. There are people in here. "Kathleen, I want to go see Junior and Gene. I want to see them in heaven. I want to hear that whistle call." And it's not going to be coming from an old frail man. It's going to be coming from a young, vibrant, alive man of God. I want to see that day. And Jesus made sure. He said, "I'm going to catch you away so you can come be with me." Hallelujah. Hallelujah. What a day that will be. Isn't that great? Amen. 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 My wife has two wonderful little Presbyterian grandparents waiting on her. Mr. and Mrs. Babb loved the Lord with all their hearts. Took her to the Presbyterian church when she lived with them. I've got Mrs. Babb's Bible at home, Knave's Topical Bible. And that woman was a spiritual woman. She went through that Bible and wrote things down. And I can't wait to see them. We're not just being reminiscing. We're not just being nostalgic. It's going to happen. My mamaw is there right now with coal black hair. Just as Indian as she can be. Amen. Amen. My Grandpa Palmer's standing there, all 6'2" or 6'3" of him, with coal black hair, probably preaching. Amen. He walked that holler for all those years. He's now walking them golden streets. Why? Because he is the righteous dead, and his spirit went directly to God. But one day his body's going to be resurrected. One day her body's going to be resurrected. One day your loved one's body's going to be resurrected. And they're going to be changed instantaneously. In the moment, in a twinkling of an eye. And we're going to forever be with him. Shh. Woo-hoo. Number five. To cause the saints to escape all those things that are coming on the earth. Oh, Jesus. Sing one more song about heaven. Hallelujah. Luke 21 and verse 36. "Watch therefore and pray always
that you may be accounted worthy to escape all these things that shall come to pass and stand before the Son of Man. Well, what things? The things in verses 9, 10, and 11. See, that word watch, it means to be alert, to be spiritually awake. Paul wrote the church in Thessalonica, and he said, of the times and seasons, brethren, you have no need that I write unto you. Nobody in here needs me to tell you that we're living in a wicked time. So my job is to watch, to be alert, to be spiritually awake. Watch, be spiritually alert. We're looking. Remember, now, okay, it's 8:05. Give me just a few minutes. I start to say a couple, but that'd be a lie. A few minutes. Amen. I don't want to lie because I want to go to heaven. Amen. I want to go in the rapture. Praise God. But here's the point. When you look at, Jesus talked about the five wise virgins, the five foolish virgins. Now, very often, you know, we delineate them, and it's true that the five wise did go in and the five foolish didn't. But here's the point. Here's the issue I want you to see. All 10 of them fell asleep. And the problem with the five foolish, they did not prepare for an event they knew was coming. You know why I'm preaching this to you tonight? It's going to happen. The rapture of the church is going to occur. It could happen before we leave this room. There's not one more prophecy that needs to be fulfilled for the rapture of the church to come to pass, because there's no prophetic alignment for the rapture of the church. Those things are in the hand of the Father. Before you get home, you could be raptured out of here. Laying in your bed, you could be raptured out of here. Getting up for work in the morning, Jesus could rapture the church out of here. What's my job? Watch, be alert, be spiritually awake. Don't get lulled to sleep by things that don't matter. I'm going to say this. There are people in here, there are issues going on and things going on. People in your life, it's a big distraction. And it's trying to distract you from these things of importance. The most important thing that you have to do is what God's asked you to do with your life. Everything else, when you make the determination, that's what I'm going to do, then everything else will fall into line. Your job is to be alert, to be spiritually awake. I'm not going to let the lust of this world and the deceitfulness of riches and the care of other things lull me to sleep where I'm not watching for an event that I know is coming. Amen. Now, there are people that will teach that if you're born again, you're automatically going in the rapture. But the problem with that is you can't really bear that out with Scripture. Amen. Because Jesus said you need to be watching to make sure you escape. Being alert. When God deals with you about something, fix it. Yes, sir, I'll deal with that right now. You need to correct this in your life. Yes, sir, I'll correct that right now. Why? He's keeping you rapture ready. He's keeping you ready to go. Amen. Living for God is not hard when you just decide it's the best way to live. Amen? Am I helping you at all? Yes. Be alert. Be spiritually awake. Tell your neighbor, be alert.
Be alert.
Be spiritually awake.
Be spiritually awake.
That doesn't mean stay up all night and pray. It means be alert. Be spiritually awake. Be more in tune into spiritual things than you are into carnal things. You understand? Anything that's going to dumb you down spiritually, stay away from it. Now, I'm going to say something that's going to sound old-fashioned. That's why you don't want to be watching some shows with some cussing in it. That kind of went, because people have this mindset, well, you know, if you're going to watch TV, you got to put up with a little cussing. No, you don't.
My wife and I made a vow, and it was a vow to the Lord, that we would not watch things with cursing in it. I'm not bragging on us. I'm just telling you. I don't want to be dumbed down. I don't want to be desensitized to that kind of stuff. There's something to be said for living holy. I'm not going to watch a bunch of stuff with murder and blood and violence. Amen. Amen. You know, people, we talk a lot about John Wayne. And I mean, John Wayne was a decent man, I guess. But here's the problem with John. You can't watch him for the cussing. Amen. I mean, if he was saying, "Praise the Lord, pilgrim," that'd be one thing. But he's not. And I grew up on a steady diet of John Wayne. What I'm trying to explain to you is, does it dumb down your spirit? I remember one time I went to the Lord and I was asking him something about secular music. Because, you know, I'm not one of those soapbox preachers. But at the same time, at the risk of being called legalistic, I'm going to say this anyway. I asked the Lord. I said, "Lord, what do you think about this?" You know what the Holy Spirit said to me? Now, I'm saying the Holy Spirit said this to me. I'm not saying this so you can go make a doctrine out of it. He said, "I don't enjoy secular music much either." That's what he said to me. Why? It dumbs our spirit down. You don't want to be listening to "All My Exes Live in Texas." Amen. Amen. Talking about all right? "Tonight the bottle let me down, and let your memory come around. Tonight I'll be the drunkest fool in town." And then come to church on Sunday, "I exalt thee." See, it dumbs me down. Because then you'll start going through a problem, and here's what you'll hear. "Tonight I'll be the drunkest fool in town." Right or wrong? Listening to them leaving songs. Amen. "Here I stand with my finger on his doorbell, and my mind goes back to what I did last night. You see, I finally talked his wife into leaving him." Well, you remember some songs like that. "And I'm just here to convince my conscience that it's all right." Ooh, you can't. That'll dumb your spirit down. You won't be spiritually alert, watchful, active. Amen. And the problem with those five foolish virgins, they were not spiritually alert, active, and watching, and they got left. Amen. There were only eight that were spiritually alert and active and watching when God told Noah to build that ark. Eight righteous souls were saved. The rest of them got left. As glorious as it will be for the church, there will be multiplied millions that do not go in the rapture. And they won't go in the rapture because they weren't alert and active and watching. Am I helping you at all? Yeah. Let me hurry. I got one more scripture. Look at Titus chapter 2. Now, this is a beautiful scripture. Now, listen to Pastor. I didn't tell you what to listen to. I'm not running down your George Strait or whatever you listen to. And I'm not telling you anybody's going to go to hell for it, but here's what I'm going to say. Your spiritual perceptivity will be limited. And in the day and age we live in, we cannot afford to have our spiritual perception dull. Titus chapter 2, verse 11. For the grace of God that bringeth salvation has appeared to all men. What's it do, Pastor? It teaches us. What's grace teach us, Pastor? That denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, godly in this present world. So grace is not a license to sin. Grace is the power over sin. I had a brother that disagreed with me to the face when I would say that. But yet it's right here. Isn't that what your Bible says? That grace teaches us to what? To deny ungodliness and worldly lust, and that we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. What are we doing as we do that? Looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. These things speak and exhort and rebuke with all authority. Let no man despise you. So he tells us that we need to speak these things about grace, and that we need to teach and speak people to people that we're to look for the blessed hope, which is the rapture of the church. He's coming. Say this. He's coming. For those who are watching. There are millions of people that do not know Jesus. Millions that do not know Jesus. I was so blessed. I'm going to brag on them a little bit. Rusty and Amy, they're going to be getting married the 25th, right, of this month. And they asked me, they said, can we have an altar call at our wedding? Yes, you can. Hallelujah. Amen. Because people need to be saved. People need to be born again. They need to know Jesus. Pastor Caldwell was with a group of ministers one time on a moose hunt up in about 300 miles from, well, less than that, from Antarctica. And some of the ministers were there. Well, Mark Hankins was one of the ministers that was there. And according to what I've been told and other stories, Mark Hankins is very evangelistic. Pastor Caldwell said he will witness to a stump if it'll stand there long enough. They were in the airport waiting on this plane to come and get them, you know, to take them where they needed to be. And there were some people over there, some guys, and bigger guys. And come find out, they were actually engineers that were up there doing some engineer work. And so Brother Mark went over to him, and he just walked over those guys, and he said, so y'all know Jesus? And they just didn't answer him. So he looked at him again and said, do y'all know Jesus? And they finally kind of hem-hawed around and said, no. And he said, well, Jesus is coming soon. Jesus is coming again. Don't you want to go to heaven? The guy looked up at him and said, no, I wouldn't know anybody there. When I heard that story, that just went all through me. No, I don't want to go. I wouldn't know anybody there. He's never heard the gospel. The truth is this, that we have a blessed hope. The rapture of the church. But there are many people in this earth, they don't have that hope. And that's why everything that we do, every avenue that we move into, every new television station, every radio broadcast, every church that is planted, every element that we use to get the gospel out is not to build a kingdom for people. It is to populate heaven and stop as many people from going to hell as we can. Amen. That's the key. Amen. We're not planting churches to build a kingdom. We're not going on TV so people can see us. We don't want aviation so we can say, look, we got a plane. I want aviation so if God says, I need you here tomorrow, and I need you here the next day, and I want you over here the day after that, I can go and do what God wants us to do when God wants us to do, because there are people in every city. There are people that live next to you. There are people that live behind you. There are people that live across the street from you. And tonight, their lives are in the balance. And we have a blessed hope that we're looking for. And they don't. And it remains up to us to be salt and light in the world. And to let our light shine before men. Jesus said, I've got a series called Being a Person of Influence. He said, let your light shine before men that they may glorify your Father which is in heaven. These are the purposes for the rapture. But there's also a purpose for us being on the earth. And Jesus said it was this, to work while it is still day, because the night comes when no man can work. That's why we go to the prisons. That's why we go to the jails. That's why we go to the juvenile detention center. That's why we have outreaches. Amen. That's why we got volunteers that drive hundreds of miles to go preach for an hour in the prison. That's why we have volunteers that go every Thursday night to Lansing. That's why we got volunteers that brave the snow and the rain and the elements to go do what we're doing. Why? Because there's souls in the balance. Every soul is precious to Jesus. Every soul is precious to God. They were so precious that He sent His Son to die for them. That's why we support missions work in Africa and Pastor Eddie's life. That's why we support his churches, because he's getting people saved. He's not building a kingdom unto himself. He's building a kingdom unto God and seeing people born again and saved. That's why we're investing the money in the Little Rock Church that we're investing, because there are people that are coming that are getting saved, that are getting set free, that their lives are being turned around. And guess what? When the trumpet sounds, they'll be ready to go. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. We exist to produce a spiritual production center that produces life, city, state, nation, and world. And we're going to preach it, and we're going to put it on every available voice. Amen. We're going to preach it. Jesus saves, Jesus heals, Jesus delivers, Jesus will put your marriage back together, Jesus will fix your family, Jesus will bless you, and Jesus will bless you, and bless you, and bless you, and bless you. And then when that trumpet sounds, if anybody doesn't go, you can have everything I got. But we gone. Amen. You can have my motorcycle. You can have my SUV. You can have everything. But on that great getting up morning, I'm going to get up out of the ground. Amen. Will you help tonight? I think sometimes we just need to come to church and just be encouraged. Your best days are yet ahead of you. Amen. And everything God has told you, it shall surely come to pass. Hallelujah. Let's stand up tonight. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. 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 Praise the Lord. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for your wonderful grace. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. 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 You know, even here on a Wednesday night with your eyes closed, if you're here tonight and you would just say, you know, Pastor, I just want to be 100% sure that there's nothing between me and God. I'm not talking you think you're a sinner, but you're here tonight and you've heard some of the things I've said, and you're in your heart, you're just saying, you know what? I want to make sure I'm ready. I want to make a commitment. I just want to be sure that I'm ready. It may not be you, but it may be somebody next to you. If that's you, with every eye closed. If that's you, say, Pastor, I just want to be sure I'm ready. Just slip your hand up. Slip your hand up, wherever you're at. Thank you. Thank you for that hand. Anybody else? Thank you for those hands. Anybody else? I just want to be sure I'm ready. I want to be sure I'm ready. Thank you for that hand. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Well, come on, say this with me. Father, in the name of Jesus. Anything that may be in my life that stands between you and I, I lay it down tonight. I make the choice to lay it aside and live for you, because I want to be ready when that trumpet sounds. In Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, take the hand of your neighbor tonight. Glory be to God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Gentlemen, don't forget Saturday morning. We're going to have a great time at men's meeting. Hallelujah. And then we'll be back here Sunday morning. Amen. With some more good word. Amen. Praise God. Didn't Pastor Tony do a good job this past weekend? Amen. We're grateful to have such good preachers. Amen. So tell your neighbor, the vision of our church will always be to build people's faith and frame their world by the word of God. You and I will always be world changers. God bless you. You taking my notes?